I presume you're here in order to learn of Magecraft. I'll have you know, there's no room for the weak-willed in this course. And despite your best efforts, the sorcery of our time is but a fraction of what it once was in the Age of Gods. Much of the craft is established through pedigree, and the culture of mages is riddled with deception and moral depravity. That said, if you insist, I shall do my best to educate you in this miserable, yet fascinating world. In our previous lesson, we went over a much more natural aspect of our world, focusing on phantasmal species that dominated in the Age of Gods. In contrast, today we will be looking toward the future for innovations of Magecraft. Specifically, we will be talking about Spiritrons, which have vastly expanded the very concept of what Magecraft can be. Just like any other human, mages too are subject to stereotypes. A popular one is that mages are terrible with technology. While they may excel with building and utilizing mystic codes, it is true that traditional mages struggle with more contemporary technology. That said, there is no rule stating that mages cannot embrace new ideas. In fact, one could argue such an open mind is absolutely essential for the modern mage. After all, mystery is in decline, and has been ever since the gods departed our world in response to our reliance on science. Thus, to assume all mages are quaint and stubborn like that would be the pinnacle of ignorance. Groups such as the Atlas Institute and Caldea Security Organization prove that Magecraft goes hand in hand with technological prowess. On the forefront of this innovation is Spiritron technology, which is essentially a fresh perspective on a classic element, the soul. Living beings are comprised of three main aspects: the body, mind, and soul. Of these, the soul is arguably the most important aspect for being a record of the body, and even containing a mage's magic circuits. In that regard, the body is merely a material terminal for the soul. Even with the loss of the body, so long as a person's soul remains, their very being can be restored through the records of their soul, assuming another body is procured. After all, for as eternal as the soul can be, it cannot remain in the material world without a body to contain it. Without such a vessel, souls inevitably return to the root whence they came. When a soul is still present in our world, it can be physically detected as a set of quantum particles called spiritrons. Mages willing to embrace scientific knowledge and technology have been able to use spiritrons in ways that greatly expand human potential. Most commonly, spiritrons can be projected into interfaces such as computers, and thanks to Caldea's ray-shift system, into other time periods, effectively allowing humans to travel back in time. These projections, called pseudo-spiritrons, can be thought of as packets of data, information stored about a person's consciousness and genetics. This is useful for projecting humans into avatars in a virtual environment, but spiritrons are also ideal for storing all manner of data, allowing for extremely efficient spiritron computers. Using spiritrons in this way, it's possible to create vast information networks that are years ahead of civilian tech. In some worlds, this innovation is absolutely essential. In the various timelines we refer to as extra worlds, Earth suffered a great collapse in the 1970s, resulting in the end of traditional magecraft as the mana needed to perform it dried up. The mages of old became obsolete, and in their place, more technologically savvy mages took over, utilizing a process called spiritron hacking to perform their craft in an entirely digital space. The future of these worlds falls not onto the prosperity of the Earth, but rather the existence of the Moon Cell, a massive supercomputer on the Moon that's been around for over 100 million years. While we can only speculate its origin, its central database, the Moon Cell Automaton, has been recording the universe's history in a manner similar to the Root's Akashic Records. Beyond storing records, the automaton also contains a vast artificial environment known as the Serial Phantasm, or Seraph for short. Hoping to take shelter in this virtual space, Spiritron hackers would, naturally, hack into Seraph, projecting into it their own souls converted into pseudo-spiritrons. Many of these hackers continue their magecraft not through channeling the Earth's mana, but by executing computer programs. As such, the mages of the Moon Cell are more aptly called wizards, if only to distinguish them apart from the mages of old. Wizard spells, known as code casts, convert traditional incantations into pre-compiled code, only requiring the wizard's own mana for activation. Such codes can be stored externally through consumable objects, but they are most effective when installed directly into a wizard's virtual avatar, though this has the chance of altering their nature, so it comes at a risk. The very first Spiritron hacker was a man named Twice H. Peaceman. After being orphaned during the Earth's Great Collapse, he survived through warfare to become a scientist. While not a traditional Magus, he started Spiritron hacking as part of his research to cure a disease known as amnesia syndrome. While his body was destroyed in a bioterrorist attack, his Spiritron data was used by the Moon Cell as an NPC in the Moon Cell Grail Wars. Other significant Spiritron hackers include Shinji Mato. As the son of an influential mage family, Shinji would have fared poorly as a traditional mage, but as a wizard, he excelled. His penchant for online gaming helped him strive in virtual environments. Thanks to new technology, an otherwise inept mage can be seen as formidable by brilliant mages like Rin Tosaka. Another wizard who didn't exactly start as a typical mage is Kiara Sesshoin, a daughter of the Shingon Tachikawa Eiten School of Buddhism. Despite being ill and bedridden for her first 14 years of life, she was able to make a name for herself by learning Spiritron hacking from her like-minded worshippers. This allowed her to form a strong presence on the internet, reforming the Tachikawa Eiten School into a cult centered around worshipping her. One sign of a skilled Spiritron hacker comes from the ability to change one's avatar. While the Moon Cell assigns combatants their clothing, placing them into one of several roles at school, certain mages are quick to hack those designs in lieu of their own. Runru, otherwise known as Lil Ronnie, was a rather twisted competitor with an eating disorder. In contrast to her thin body, she wears the costume of a popular burger joint's mascot. It goes without saying that her clown attire is anything but standard. The mage Julius B. Harvey entered the Mooncell Grail War under unique circumstances. Through hacking, he first entered the war by using the personal data of Soichiro Kuzuki, a school teacher. Hacking allowed him to find the data of another NPC and use that data as a false identity. Much like Shinji, the mage Jineko Karigiri developed her talent for technology by mastering video games. As an accidental captive of BB's Sakura Labyrinth, she used her expertise in Spiritron hacking to create a virus used to weaken BB's sentinel Meltrilis. However, hacking needn't be used for such extreme purposes. Pfluger, a Middle Eastern spellcaster, was able to use his Spiritron hacking to encrypt data sent over the internet to securely message Lord El-Maloy II. The Atlas Institute found use in Spiritrons both in and out of extra worlds. The alchemist Sion Eltnam Atlasia fights with a nanofilament wire called Aetherlight. While it can be swung like a whip, Sion's Aetherlight is primarily meant for tapping into her enemy's nervous system, letting her read their thoughts and memories. Given that such things are recorded into a person's soul, the Aetherlight is considered a form of Spiritron hacking. Similarly, as the soul contains magic circuits, the creation of homunculi with circuits can also be thought of as manipulating Spiritrons. Perhaps the best example is Rani the Eighth, a special homunculi made by Atlas's Sealam Eltnam Re Atlasia. Not only does Rani have magic circuits, but at her core is a Spiritron computer named Hermes, a smaller form of Atlas's supercomputer Tri-Hermes. Despite hacking the Moon Cell to exist within Seraph as a virtual entity, her self-destruct protocol, Mode Osiris, has the potential to corrupt the Moon Cell by overloading her magic circuits in case her mission fails. Naturally, the Caldea security organization wouldn't have been established without the help of technology from Atlas. When its first director, Marisbury Animosphere, claimed victory in the Holy Grail of Fuyuki in the year 2004, he wished upon the Grail for the wealth needed to fully realize Caldea, a facility that could monitor the continued well-being of humanity. At its core is Caldeas, the simulated global environment model. It uses part of what we consider to be the planet's soul, Alaya, to replicate the Earth as a miniature that can be observed in both the past, present, and future. Its shape is formed of high-density Spiritrons that can only be observed by a lens known as Sheba. Should a human actually touch Caldeus directly, they will be decomposed on a molecular level akin to being swallowed by a small sun. Aside from its comprehensive fate servant summoning system, Caldeus' greatest asset is its ray-shifting technology. It surpasses the brilliance of even Spiritron hacking in that, rather than projecting one's soul into a virtual space, it allows a person to project their soul onto another point in time. The result is a genuine, physical form of time travel that Caldea uses primarily in the correction of historical anomalies, or singularities. Normally, time travel would fall under the domain of true magic, but Caldea found a way to achieve something practically similar by taking a person's soul, converting it into pseudo-spiritrons, and projecting those onto Caldeas at various time periods. Rayshift subjects even bypass the counterforce, being perceived as phantasmal beings. Even so, ray-shifting is incredibly dangerous and requires the soul be able to verify its existence through quantum observation. Certain ray-shift candidates are more compatible with this process than others, and to ensure this process even further, Caldea uses machines called Klein coffins, which can shut down in an emergency, preserving a master's vitals through cryogenic freezing. Verifying a person's existence across time, as well as monitoring their vitality and the current state of singularities, demands tremendous computation. To handle this, Caldea has its own supercomputer, Trismegistus, built by Atlas using the same tech as their computer, Trihermes. As such, Trismegistus is a Spiritron computer that is essential to maintaining a master's existence remains tied to both the past and present. Lastly, I want to mention that heroic spirits, like the ones summoned by Caldea, are effectively spiritual beings, and as such, their shape and appearance are dictated by their soul. While a servant can certainly wear clothing from the era to which they're summoned, their basic appearance can always be restored from the blueprint imprinted on their soul. As such, another way for servants to change appearance is to alter their own saint graphs, engraving new outfits onto their souls. Such costume changes are classified as Spiritron dresses, and often accompany a servant as they attempt to redefine or explore certain aspects of their legend or personality. In summation, Spiritrons are a discovery that has helped bridge the traditional practices of Magecraft with modern science. By acknowledging these quantum particles of the soul, mages can alter or project themselves into various times and places. For many, this means learning to access the Moon Cell as a Spiritron hacker, a wizard that performs through Seraph's virtual reality. Compared to traditional Magecraft, Spiritron hackers don't necessarily require the greatest magic circuits, which is a tremendous advantage should the Earth's mana deplete. In some cases, the very future of humanity depends on Spiritron technology. Caldea, for instance, uses Spiritrons to essentially perform time travel, a phenomenon needed to resolve singularities that risk sending the human order into chaos. With a more thorough understanding of the soul, I feel it is now possible to talk about the most famous aspect of Magecraft, the ability to summon Earth's epic heroes as heroic spirits. Thus, for our next lesson, I will finally discuss the true nature of servants, not exclusively as familiars, but as the protectors of humanity. Thanks for watching!
If you enjoy this channel, help us grow by liking, commenting, sharing the video, subscribing to OtakuDaiKun, and
most of all, smashing that notification bell so you don't miss out on all of our anime discussion, lore, or Let's Play content.
You can support us directly through Patreon, Subscribestar, or our YouTube membership, all of which come with benefits like exclusive vids and early access.
As always,
celebrate your fandom!